There have been a lot of really great races in NASCAR's history, and thankfully most of them are available on YouTube in full. Whether you're just trying to relive that 90s bullring brawl in the Busch series from your childhood, or relish that one absurd Cup Series restart from Atlanta in 2004, chances are someone has uploaded it onto the site. This is thanks to NASCAR's lax policy when it comes to enforcing their copyrights on YouTube. Yeah, they might monetize your video for their own benefit, but so long as you haven't posted a full race from the last 4 or 5 years, they'll usually let it slide. This is great for NASCAR nerds such as myself, because I can come home and unwind with a great race from my high school days, or intently watch an underappreciated knockdown drag-out slugfest that managed to fly under my radar. One race that falls under the latter category is the 2012 Hall of Fame 150 from Bowman Gray Stadium. If you've never seen or heard about Bowman Gray Stadium, then let me be the first to introduce you to this absurd little track. Have you ever looked at your high school's track and field circuit and thought, wouldn't it be great if me and my friends took the place over and raced our piece of crap cars here out in front of a few thousand people in the grandstands? Well, someone out in Winston-Salem, North Carolina had that exact same idea. The only difference being is they actually went out and did it. In 1937, a football stadium was built for the Wake Forest University football team as part of a public works project during the Great Depression. At some point, someone made a horse racing circuit around the field, and someone else decided to just start racing cars on the track instead in 1939. In 1947, the track was paved by the city of Winston-Salem on the agreement that the track owner would split a portion of ticket sales with the city. And, fun fact, before the first payment was posted, the promoter skipped town, took off with all the money, and was never heard from again. Fast forward to 1958, and Bowman Gray gets its first NASCAR Cup Series race, which was won by Bob Welborn in May of that year. The venue would be a staple of the schedule for nearly a decade and a half, having 2 or even 3 race dates per year for most of its tenure. At its height, they managed to jam 29 cars at a time on this quarter-mile track, and the stadium more than earned its nickname, the Madhouse. It's a tight track with nowhere to run and nowhere to hide, and since it has 0 degrees of banking, the only practical line is to run as close to the grass as possible. With so little real estate to work with, negotiations for track position usually end up with some serious contact and some even more seriously hurt feelings. The madness didn't even stay contained to the racing surface either. In 1971, at the last NASCAR Cup race at the track, the winner, Bobby Allison, eventually had his win rescinded by NASCAR officials. Why? Well, he was driving an illegal car. Kind of. You see, at that time, if NASCAR couldn't get a full field of cars for their top series, they would have the cars from the lower division qualify for the race too. You may recall the first race at Talladega in 1969 being made up almost entirely of lower division cars, due to a tire scandal and an eventual driver boycott. This was somewhat controversial because the Cup Series had strict body templates that every manufacturer had to adhere to, and the lower divisions usually ran pony cars like Mustangs, Camaros, and Barracudas, as opposed to the top series that ran Torinos, Chevelles, and Chargers. NASCAR officials instead usually never subjected these lower-level cars to inspection and just shoehorned them into the field. This had never been a real problem, though, as these pony cars usually had smaller engines and short wheelbases, making them slower at most tracks, and thus not a factor to surpass the big dogs. However, Bobby Allison, a veteran of nearly a decade of NASCAR Cup Series competition, elected to start the race in a 1970 Ford Mustang owned by Melvin Joseph, as opposed to his usual ride. At a flat quarter-mile track, the shorter wheelbase and lower horsepower would actually be a benefit to him rather than a detriment, as it would help him roll through the corners better. He led 138 of the 250 laps that day and bested Richard Petty by 3 seconds, a huge margin of victory for that little old track. But pretty soon, everyone who was driving a normal Cup car complained about Bobby driving a Mustang, saying it gave him an unfair advantage, and to this day, Bobby Allison's official win total, according to NASCAR, sits at 84 instead of 85. This would be somewhat trivial if it were not for the fact that Allison's longtime rival, Darrell Waltrip, also sits at 84 wins. And this win at Bowman Gray would put him one ahead of the Tennessee Traveler. But then again, Darrell probably should have been credited with that win in North Wilkesboro in 1990 rather than Brett Bodine, so we'll call it a wash. But wait a second. So if Bobby Allison didn't have the win counted, does that mean that Richard Petty won this race? Does that mean his 200 Cup Series wins is total BS? It should actually be 199? Well, no, because he didn't win this race either. According to the NASCAR record books, no one won this race. Yeah, the Madhouse is just that. A damned madhouse. In 1972, NASCAR entered what we now know as the modern era, where dirt tracks as well as any tracks measuring less than half a mile in length were removed from the schedule. This meant that a lot of legacy tracks like Hickory, South Boston, and Bowman Gray were left to fend for themselves. But whereas Hickory and the others got Busch Series races to supplement their weekly racing schedules, Bowman Gray Stadium had to rely on its weekly racing features exclusively. The small college town of Winston-Salem kept the stadium afloat with rabid turnout to the weekly races, that and the dozens of high school and college football games in the fall. But I think that should change. I think NASCAR ought to bring its top divisions back to the Madhouse. It more than deserves it. And my case is as follows. The 2012 Hall of Fame 150 in the K&N East Series. The K&N East Series is a sort of Division 4 feeder series that tours up and down the East Coast, competing at mostly short tracks. They had raced at Bowman Gray in 2011, but the race that really captured my attention was a sophomore race in 2012. That race was an absolute banger. First off, let's take a look at the starting grid. Kyle Larson won the pole with Corey LaJoie on the outside. Bubba Wallace and Chase Elliott bring up the third row. 2018 Truck Series champion Brett Moffitt starts in 7th, and Daniel Suarez in 13th. This reads like the starting lineup for a 2019 Cup race. We got some big names in the race, and here's where they all cut their teeth. An absurd little quarter-mile track built around a football field. Life is strange like that, I guess. We also got some oddballs in the field. Sean Case, a longtime competitor in the series, starts in the second row. Dale Quarterly, who made his first starts in the series before some of these guys in the field were even born, is here. And Travis Pastrana, yeah, that Travis Pastrana, starts on the last row due to problems in qualifying. And overall, four different nationalities are represented tonight. Now, this race on paper should have been pretty cringe-inducing. There were only two lead changes all night, and Corey LaJoie led 118 of the 150-lap event, nearly 79% of the race. There were a stupid number of cautions that accounted for 39% of the race being run under yellow, and the average green flag stint was just 8.5 laps long. But therein lies the magic of Bowman Gray Stadium. It can take a race that would have been horrible at any other venue and turn it into must-watch TV. Most of the cautions were the result of simple bump and runs that ended up with some guy pulling a quick 180 or 360 and continuing on his way. Passing at Bowman Gray is kind of like performing open heart surgery with a broadsword. Yeah, technically you can do it, but it's not going to be pretty. That being said, Corey LaJoie took the lead from Larson on the outside on the first lap, and then came back and retook it for good from the outside again on lap 38. His car was just that much better. Or maybe Corey LaJoie's the GOAT and we just haven't realized it yet. Either way, Corey LaJoie would never relinquish the lead from here on out. After a few quick cautions, a restart on lap 47 shows Bowman Gray's one big flaw. There isn't any pit road, and its stand-in might be a little bit dangerous. The pits for Bowman Gray are actually on the outside of the track, and you have to go through the openings in the wall in turns 3 and 4 to exit and enter the track, respectively. On that restart, Daniel Suarez in the 14 locks up the rear brakes entering the corner, loses it, and smacks the guardrails right at the pit entrance, riding up the wall in a scary-looking crash. He was thankfully uninjured, which shouldn't come as a big surprise considering the overall low speed of the track. Although it looks pretty crazy, it's actually far less dangerous than the wrecks you see at Talladega or Daytona, which happen at nearly four times the speed. The race continues on at nearly the same tempo. Lots of spins, bent sheet metal, and hurt feelings. And all of that comes to a head on the final restart. After a little tangle between Ryan Gifford and Chase Elliott, what's left of the field restarts for a green-white checkered. Everyone's pretty haggard. Bubba Wallace has almost completely lost his right front fender. I'm surprised Carlos Iaconelli in the 15 can even see out of his car. And Brett Moffitt's front and back bumpers are completely spent. Meanwhile, Corey LaJoie's car looks like it just rolled off the hauler. Yeah, he's been up front all night, and most green flag stints were around 10 laps, but the track is so short you can run into lap traffic after 6 or 7 laps. Even still, Corey has managed to pick off lapped cars without damaging his own ride. Bubba Wallace starts on the outside and sends it into turn 1 as soon as the green flag falls. He locks up the tires, swings a little bit wide, and that causes a jam up behind him. With just 2 laps remaining, everyone scrambles to get whatever positions they can nab up, and complete anarchy ensues. Somehow they make it back to the white flag without a caution coming out, and in turn 2 on the last lap, Brian Ortiz in the 4 dumps Iaconelli, and almost at the same instant, Bubba Wallace dumps Brett Moffitt. Ortiz sees an opening and tries to run down Bubba but can't get to him. Corey at this point has opened up a comfortable lead and cruises to his first K&N East Series win. After the race, Brett Moffitt and Bubba Wallace get out of their cars and get into it on the track. And Bubba tries his damnedest to spend the night in jail. The crowd is going wild, and I almost forgot to mention this incredible battle for 7th at the line between Brandon Godovic in the 46 and Ben Kennedy in the 96. That ended up with Godovic getting the better of Kennedy in a margin of victory that had to be less than 1/100 of a second. This crazy, wacky, wild race under the light of the full moon is my case for bringing back Bowman Gray Stadium to the NASCAR schedule. It was just too much damned fun. And I'm not just talking about a truck series or an Xfinity series race at the Madhouse either. No, I want a cup race at this track. Now I know what you're thinking. That is absurd. How could we possibly justify a cup date at this little quarter-mile track out in Winston-Salem that can't even hold 20,000 people? We have 36 weeks of competition already, and you're blowing our chance to add real tracks like Nashville and Road America to the schedule with this meaningless farce of a racetrack. Okay, I hear you, but I have a solution for this little conundrum. We want more short tracks, right? We also want to return to NASCAR's roots, right? And we want midweek races too, right? Well, let's kill three birds with one stone. Since Winston-Salem isn't that far from Charlotte, where pretty much all the teams are based, how about we do this? Right in between the All-Star Race and the Coca-Cola 600, both at Charlotte Motor Speedway, we have some Wednesday night NASCAR and go to the Madhouse. It's not going to cost these teams a whole lot to drive an hour up the highway for a one-day show. You park the hauler Tuesday night, unload in the morning, practice starts at 10, qualifying starts at 3, a 50-lap B main for the back half of the qualifying field, top 2 transfer into the A main, and a 200-lap shootout to determine the main event winner. Then you hustle back down to Charlotte and prepare for the 600 on Thursday afternoon. You want speed weeks? How about that for speed weeks? Three exciting must-watch races in just 8 days, and all of them a different cup of tea as well. You get NASCAR's best battling it out in a million-dollar shootout in the All-Star Race, a beating and banging short track slugfest, and then a 600-mile endurance race to wrap it all up. But Bowman Gray Stadium is just a demolition derby masquerading around as a race, I hear you bemoan. It's just dumb, knuckle-dragging, lowest common denominator garbage. That junk does not belong on the NASCAR Cup Series schedule. To which, I will concede your point. Yes, a race at Bowman Gray is just a demolition derby pretending to be a race. Yes, it is stupid, but you know what else it is? Fun. And fun sells and puts a lot of asses in seats. I mean, look at these stands. They're packed. For a K&N race, 17,000 people dropped their weekend plans and drove out to Winston-Salem, North Carolina for a fourth-tier series NASCAR race. That's impressive. And about the point that this is just a demolition derby, I could make the same argument about Daytona or Talladega. Actually, those races are far more destructive, dangerous, and not too infrequently you have guys who have no business winning a top-tier series race winding up in victory lane. Listen, we have 36 weeks of perfectly normal, legitimate, well, almost 36 weeks of perfectly normal, legitimate racing. We have all the regular-ass racing we could ever want. So just once a year, give me this stupid, meaningless farce of a race. Give me the big, dumb, stupid fun of a demolition derby. Give me the catharsis of watching Bubba Wallace shove a cop out of the way. It's dumb and unnecessarily destructive, but that's kind of the point of NASCAR. To go out there, beat and bang, and maybe actually put on a race at some point. And may the best driver win. Corey LaJoy managed to weather the storm and win straight up with pretty much a completely unscathed car. Why can't Kyle Busch or Joey Logano? The cream will rise to the top, as it always does. I say give him a chance. Let us return to NASCAR's roots. Let us return to chaos. Let us reject modernity and return to the Madhouse.